So it was inspired by looking back at my high school experience and wishing that I would have been braver and stronger to live my authentic truth. Instead, I waited many years until I finally came out and I felt like it was time to go back and hopefully make a piece of art that would resonate with audiences and that someone would see themselves in this film and hopefully feel less alone was our goal for At Last.
Well, I gotta tell you, I'm really interested in the film because my sister, who's married to a very beautiful woman, went through a similar experience herself, and me being her brother, probably one of the first people she came out to. I understand the situation, even though I might not have the same experience as the central character. I understand this is the family situation, and yes, Latino families can be way more understanding than you'd think. At least it was in ours, and I'm looking forward to seeing yours.
Thank you. Yeah, that's so exciting. And yet my brother was the first person I came out to. So there you
That's
go.
beautiful. I'm gonna start crying right now. I haven't even seen the short.
Este verano, solo hay un lugar donde podrás encontrar los mejores contadores de historias latinas. La Leaf. Cine. Música. Televisión. Arte. Legado. El Festival Internacional de Cine Latino en Los Ángeles. La LIF, la casa del contenido latino.
So Diana Cadavid, Lorena Gordon, and Jorge Molina.
Yes.
Awesome. Great to have all of you here. Great to have you LALIFers here, as well as one of the filmmakers. And Lorena, we'll get to your film At Last in a little bit. So I guess I should start off with Jorge, who's the programming coordinator. It's cool to have Lalif back. Still some virtual stuff going on, but a lot of in-person stuff going on this year too. Can you just talk to us a little bit about what's new with 2021 and what's kind of come back with 2021's edition of Lalif?
Yeah, of course. Well, it's certainly different from last year where we had to, do it fully virtual. But, talking about what we wanted this edition to be like, it's our 20th edition. It's kind of like a great landmark for us. So we wanted to kind of bring, we fortunately were fortunate enough to be able to bring back in-person screenings as we start developing. But last year when we did the virtual screenings, we also realized there's a lot of great advantages of having online programming. We felt very connected to a lot of parts in the world. So we definitely wanted to keep that global outreach present. So we kind of are able to get the best of both worlds by having, in-person screenings, people back on theaters, and be able to show some of the best of Latin American cinema, but at the same time, still keep that connection going online for those who are not able to attend.
And for those of people that are just new to this festival, LALIF stands for Los Angeles Latino Independent Film Festival.
Los Angeles Latino International Film Festival.
Ah, God, I always get that one wrong. And Rafael Agustin, who's a good friend of mine, corrects me every year. Let's say this one more time, the Los Angeles Latino International Film Festival.
Yes, and that international, we really have wanted to really underline that part by like bringing films from, not only US Latinx, which is so important for us to highlight and focus on, but also other talents from all other, Spanish-speaking countries from Central South America. So it is very important for us to bring everyone together.
Awesome. Diana, you're the artistic director of LALIF.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about what that job entails and what's new for yourself in regards to what LALIF is doing this year.
Well, basically, my job, what my job entails is to conceptualize, give shape to the program, to the way we're moving forward, making the decisions on the films that come in, and also inviting co-programmers and people that can also add to designing the program, designing who we want to invite. So it is my job to have the vision for what are the filmmakers, what are the stories that we want to bring, in which direction we want to move forward, and how we want the festival to have an impact both with like our audience, but also with the filmmakers in the community. But not only filmmakers, artists in general, you know, we are a multi-arts festival. We're not only focused on film and episodics. We also have programming for music, for arts, which is something that we're very proud of. You know, we try to push the boundaries that divide different like disciplines, genres, and way to express through art. So that's kind of like in a nutshell what my job is. I mean, at this point we are everything. We are RSVPing, we are doing all the tech for bringing films in, preparing for the red carpets, preparing for the virtual events. So it's a super exciting time, very, very exciting time.
And, you know, and I do, I have seen Lalif grow and expand beyond films. You know, first they expanded from films to episodics, from U.S. Projects to international Latin American projects, from just, you know, a film and TV content. Now we're doing art and music, which is really cool. Alexis Dararocha is a good friend of mine. I know she's working with the musical aspect of the show. What can you speak to us, and you know, Diana and Jorge, you can speak to this, and Lorena, we're gonna get you. We're gonna save the best for last one because we're gonna talk to someone who actually has a film in the festival. But can those of you that are working with Lalif talk about the kind of content? I mean, we can focus on film, but you can talk about the rest of it. The kind of content, the kind of content creators that you're trying to give an opportunity to expose to, you know, the entertainment industry.
Well, we are first and foremost like all about diversity, inclusion, and expanding our way to understand how we want to tell our stories and how we want our stories to be told by other people. So we definitely have a program that is very diverse in every sense of the word, you know? So 57% of the program is directed by women, which is very, you know, like I think it's fantastic based on like the numbers from like other festivals and even in previous years of our festival, the fact that 57% of the program is directed by women, it's like fantastic. We are very conscious on like bringing filmmakers of color, filmmakers from the queer community, filmmakers from like the LGBTQ plus community. But above all, like we want to bring projects that open conversations that add to the global conversation of our times. And again, you know, like how do we see each other? How do we react to the things that happen in our times? And that doesn't mean that all the works are necessarily political in like in the sense that political is understood more broadly, but we definitely have stories that either through comedy, through genre films, you know, like horror or suspense or drama, are telling what our community feels, the things that we want to explore and how we, you know, like expand reach and have an impact in how the country and the world is shaped, you know? So basically like we make a huge effort to be very inclusive and to not shy away from conversations that are very important this time in history. Nice. We are part of history, you know, so.
Yeah, I think it's very important for us to just expand on the limits of what the definition of Latino filmmaking or Latino storylines are. I think when you say that there can be a couple of maybe like stories or genres that jump at you when as an industry as a whole, you describe your story as a Latinx focused or like a Latino filmmaker. And we wanna show with this festival that no, these stories come in all shapes and all forms. We want, like Diana said, bring in, you know, genre, horror, comedy, any like all shapes and forms. We have an incredible, like for example, animation program this year, you know, with our partners in Latinx, the group Latinx in Animation. So there's like a thriving Latinx and animation branch of filmmaking. So we want to make sure that it's not, we just don't have like two or three stories in us. We have like thousands, and we want to, you know, be a showcase for those.
Awesome. And speaking of showcasing, Lorena, you have a short film, right? And what category is this in?
We're in the Roots block for our live in-person screening. And for the virtual Jorge, remind me again.
Yeah, so basically, like, we have a competition of shorts, a live action shorts. So Lorena's is part of the shorts competition.
And it's called At Last. I just want to, I forgot to get the title in, but go ahead.
Yeah, no, I was just like sort of like explaining that we call like the programs at different ways just for in order for people to access them either virtually or in person. But the film is part of our like fantastic, which I'm so happy, I have to say, Lorena, to have like your film. And also, you know, like, yeah, it's a competition of very diverse and beautiful short films.
How many short films are in the competition?
We are almost at 30. I don't have the exact number, but it is almost 3,000 of all different countries, genres, languages. It's a little bit of everything for everyone.
Amazing. Lorena, tell us about the short. What's it about? At Last.
Sure. So first of all, thank you, Jorge and Diana, for having us. We were super excited to come to be here in LA and screen the film. And showcase it with your audience. So thank you. It's such an honor, honestly. At Last is a coming of age film about a teenage girl who musters up the courage to come out to her family and come out to herself with the help of her best friend.
Amazing. Well, and just tell us a little bit more about how long are, you know, a lot of times people, you know, short films, what is this, like a 5-minute thing? Is it a 20 minute?
Sure. So it's a 13-minute piece with an incredible cast led by up-and-coming actress Katie Burton. We have Zach Godsagan from Peanut Butter Falcon, George Lopez, Marlene Forte, and Trisha Brooks to line up the cast.
Yeah, I've heard of some of those names. so how'd you get, you know, someone like George Lopez and even some of the actors that I know, Marlene Forte as well. How'd you get some of these performers to be part of your short?
Sure. So Marlene, I had worked with before, and she's family. Any project, I always have her in mind, and she read the script and loved it and wanted to jump on board again. And George, I was talking about this earlier. I honestly wrote with him in mind, and the universe conspired, and serendipitously, I had the opportunity to meet him and pitch him the idea. And he wanted to support me as an up and coming director. And it's a testament, like I said, to his character of him wanting to help the community and tell stories like these. So he said yes, and we were very fortunate to have him jump on board and want to be a part of this film.
What does he play in the film? I'm assuming the dad?
Yes, he plays the dad. And it's a role that we're super excited for audiences to see. You know, he everyone knows him for his comedic work, but here we see a very heartwarming and understanding Latino father, and we break that stereotype of the, you know, macho mentality, and we just see a tender heart-to-heart moment that he has with his daughter.
Who wrote the film?
I wrote it as well.
So you wrote and directed it?
I wrote and directed it, yeah. So it was inspired by looking back at my high school experience and wishing that I would have been braver and stronger to live my authentic truth. Instead, I waited many years until I finally came out, and I felt like it was time to go back and hopefully make a piece of art that would resonate with audiences, and that someone would see themselves in this film and hopefully feel less alone was our goal for At Last.
Well, I got to tell you, I'm really interested in the film because my sister, who's married to a very beautiful woman, you know, went through a similar experience herself, and me being her brother, probably one of the first people she came out to. I understand the situation, even though I might not have the same experience as the central character. I understand this is the family situation, and yes, Latino families can be way more understanding than you'd think. At least it was in ours, and I'm looking forward to seeing yours.
Thank you. Yeah, that's so exciting. And my brother was the first person I came out to. So
that's beautiful. I'm gonna start crying right now. I haven't even seen the short. What do you guys, Jorge? What do you think about what, you know, when you're hearing this filmmaker talk about their project and how it's resonating just with us on the call? And how do you feel about giving a platform for these kind of filmmakers?
Well, that's the main goal that we have. I mean, we. I always said, and I, you know, I've worked in festivals for a few years now, and yes, it's always exciting for me, you know, to share with audiences and to share it with new people. But for me, one of the most exciting parts is also having the filmmakers themselves, just like being able to to share their stories and kind of like to a community members, and especially after a full year that, you know, we weren't able to physically be in like with each other. The fact that a lot of these people, even though their short films have played in festivals before, that this will be their first in-person, you know, big screen debut, that's super exciting and an honor for us to just, you know, as someone who has also had their films like shown on a big screen, there's few feelings as exciting as just being able to see the work you've done like on a big screen. So I love being able to be part of an organization that like facilitates that and makes it happen for Latinx people.
What's cool about the organization, I mean, obviously you're giving a platform to a lot of filmmakers that have not had a lot of exposure yet, but you also got some established people that are in different projects. I mean, even just having George Lopez on you know this new filmmaker's short is very cool. You guys are although it's not the official world premiere, Diana was giving me the official way to put it before we started, but In the Heights is at least somehow associated with the festival, because you guys are going to have a special presentation of that film, and that's major. And then opening night, you guys are going to open, the official opening film is 7th and Union, right? Directed by a friend of mine, Anthony Nadio, who did a great movie about salsa. Remind me the name if anybody knows it.
Yeah.
I'm cutting this little part out. Until, let me see. Anthony Nadio. Who has the fastest internet?
Get right now.
I can't believe I forgot it. It's like, it's with S-H. Shine.
Fine. Wait, Anthony?
It's Shine.
Oh, Shine. Okay, perfect. Right. Yeah. Right. Start again. Mm-hmm. So you guys are starting, you know, with, you know, a movie, 7th and Union, that's directed by a friend of mine, Anthony Nadio, who did Shine, which is about salsa, Puerto Ricans, Boricua, New York, and all that stuff. And he's really cool and an up-and-coming director. And it's starring Omar Chaparro, who is a huge comedic name in Mexico. And I actually got to interview him a couple of years ago. He was very open about the leap of faith that he took to come to the United States, kind of start down on the totem pole as talent and work his way back up, you know, with a lot of more English films and things like that, bilingual films. And so it's a really cool project to see. I also happen to be a boxing fan, so I'm interested in the film. Diana, is there anything else you can tell me about that and why that's being chosen as the opening night film?
Absolutely. I mean, we're very honored to be presenting. This is not only our opening night film, but it's also the world premiere of the film. So nobody else has seen the film before. We are the first ones who are presenting it. And it embodies what Lalif wants to do with, you know, in terms of like our support and on being a platform for Latino filmmakers in the US to tell the stories, to reach wider audiences, and to be able to share, you know, their films in a big platform with all the excitement, you know, like with the big premiere at the TCL Chinese IMAX theater, with the red carpet for the film. So yeah, you know, like having the world premiere of the film is really an honor for us. And at the same time, we are like 100% sure that we are the best place for the film. So right now we're basically launching the film into the world. And that's something that's very important about film festivals, and that I think throughout the years that more and more festivals get more established and more people get to know about them, they realize that the work of film festivals goes beyond just showing the films. It's like we open the space for these films to, from here, gain a complete different life, you know, that grows and grows and grows, and that ideally takes them to be seen by as many people as possible, either as a theatrical releases or broadcast or streaming. But yeah, you know, like basically we're putting out the film into the world. The cast and crew of the film is as diverse as our community is, you know, it tells a very heartwarming story, and it embodies a lot of the values and a lot of the ideas that we as a festival want to want to bring to the big screen. We're also closing the festival with the first feature film by Lisette Feliciano. She's like a fantastic up-and-coming filmmaker. This is her first feature, but it's been, you know, like it's made a splash in, and we are the first festival that's going to have a screening of the film in person. So we're also very happy to have Lisette and her team all on board, you know, all there to present the film. And it's been, as Jorge was mentioning earlier, it's been very exciting for us to see the response from a lot of the filmmakers who have their films have traveled through other festivals, but this is the first time that they are going to be shown in person. So
I think it's just great timing for you for the festival, because we're now we've gotten to the point where we're coming out of this enough that you can put on something in person, and it's a good position. It's a very serendipitous for LALIF, I think.
Yeah. I mean, it has definitely taken a lot of work from us to figure out in a very short period of time, like how to move from virtual to in person as things were changing, you know. So we were already like in the midst of programming when things started reopening. So we've, you know, like adapted and moved, but I think that's testament to the same thing that we did last year where, you know, like our festival was one of the first festivals that had like an actual full virtual virtual edition, you know, because we knew that it was the most important time for us to be there for people, you know. So we put together this festival in like record time, and the response was fantastic. Sorry,
Lorena, you were going to say something?
I thought you were going to say something.
Oh, no. Yeah, I was just going to say, as a filmmaker who's, like you mentioned, has traveled virtually with the film, there's nothing like an in-person screening, and that's why we are so excited, and nothing compares to that, you know, live reaction from an audience while they're watching your film. It's something that we've been dreaming about and hoping about, so I know all the film, I can speak to all the filmmakers that they are beyond excited to be in a theater finally. And thank you guys for just keeping us safe and all the protocols that you're requiring to allow this to happen.
Awesome. I think that does it. I can't wait for next week. It's going to be fun. Hopefully I run into some of you there. I can't wait to see your film, Lorena. And thanks to the LALIFers for putting this on. And let's have this be symbolic of us going to something newer and better than 2020, that's for sure. So thank you so much. And I look forward to the festival.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you.
Hasta luego.
Bye.